Welcome to Liberty Lockdown. Please scan your barcode. Your liberty ain't gone, but yeah, it's on hold. Where did it come from and where did it go?
Welcome, everybody, to another episode of Liberty Lockdown. This is Clint Russell, and I am joined once again by the brilliant and powerful Tom Luongo. What's up, Tom? How you doing, man?
Oh, I'm good, man. God, it never ceases to embarrass me when somebody gives me that kind of an intro. So I do appreciate it. Really, I'm dead serious, man. It's just so not.
Hey, I'm in the same camp.
I'm just doing my thing, and like, oh, people must like it. And I'm okay with that.
Dude, I had you on like 6 or 7 months ago, and within days of me having you on, I'm getting told by people that I need to have Tom Luongo on. And I was like, I just had him. What are you doing? I mean, your fans are voracious. They
really are. They're good people. And you know, of course, what am I going to say? Well, I think it's that, you know, I think, I don't know. I mean, we've worked really, really hard as a community to make our voice heard, and we've overcome almost every obstacle thrown at us. I can tell you that, like, the amount of shadow banning and, you know, and algorithm and suppression and all the rest of it's been just unbelievable over the last 6 years, and it's very, very clear that it's been that way. And it's, you know, is, but I just look at it, it's just par for the course. It is just what you do, and if you do good work, eventually it'll get through, and you know, that's fine. So
exactly. Well, I mean, your thesis has been one that has kind of lit a flame, much controversy, especially amongst the Austrian camp. You and I kind of went through the basics of it, so I'm just going to kind of refer people to that episode if you want to kind of get the backdrop to it. Go check that episode out. But I think that there's been a lot of new developments that are worth digging into and seeing what your read of things are. Obviously, the Federal Reserve has not reversed course on the interest rates. They have, I think they have slowed the amount of increasing, or at least the pace of it as of late. And, sure. And it seems as if most people are expecting there to be one more rate hike and then for them to hold steady. What's your expectation on that front?
Prepare to be disappointed. And I mean, and I'm arguing now with, you know, with people who I respect a lot. I mean, just metaphorically speaking, arguing, you know, this is a long form conversation that's happening in multiple rooms at the same time. Everybody's doing their interviews and everybody's doing their thing. But you know, I don't think Powell's done enough yet, because I don't see the European Union as a smoking ruin politically or economically yet. I'm sorry, he's not done. If he wants to protect the private formation of capital, you know, through what is clearly now a communist struggle session over climate change and a shame-based monetary system. This is my new talking point, as opposed to a collateral-based talking, you know, monetary system built on, you know, real assets and human toil. No, not human toil, human shame is what they want. That's what carbon credits are. Mm-hmm. Like, once you realize that that's what the fight is here, and that's what this is all about, and then you have to realize that Powell represents those guys. He represents the guys that, for better or for worse, whether you like them or you don't like them, whether you agree with their past or agree with how they've made their billions, they still believe in the private formation of capital. They may believe in the state-assisted private formation of capital. They may be corporatists, you know, by any strict definition of the term, or, you know, an even loose definition of the term. No argument. And no, but they're still better than the freaking commies over in Europe,
right,
who don't believe in the private formation of capital at all. They want to replace that with a purely public, shame-based system. Call it a social credit system, call it whatever you want, but it's about values, a values-based economy. It's not about, you know, it's not about a work-based economy. And any Austrian, you know, who argues with me about this, gets to turn in his freaking credentials card to the girl at the door. I'm sorry, but that's just the truth. I would rather be ruled by Jamie Dimon than Klaus Schwab. If I have to be ruled by somebody, because that's the world I live in, not the world I want. I'm not advocating for this.
Right.
But if I have to bow down to somebody, I'd rather bow down to Dimon at the very least, because he's going to build oil wells and let me have a pickup truck that I like. As opposed to Klaus Schwab, who's like, no, you will eat bugs and live in a pod.
I don't think I've ever dug deeper with you on this front. Is the fight between kind of the World Economic Forum and the Federal Reserve, so like the European banking institutions, the shame-based economy, are they aware that the Federal Reserve is battling them?
Okay. You think? Yeah, think. Like,
I would assume.
Like, oh my God, he's going to pivot next week. He has to pivot next week. Don't you understand? He must pivot. He'll never make it past 1%. If he doesn't pivot, it's going to be terrible for the world. I'm like, oh my God, how many times do I have to hear pivot? Like, I'm done with the word. It's like pivot might as well be a 4-letter word. Like, you know, seriously, like these people said every time Powell raised rates, oh, he's got to pivot soon. He's got to pivot. He's not going to pivot.
So he's going to hike. I mean, do you think
Clint, just let's stop.
Sure.
I don't know that he's going to hike again or not hike again. Okay. He's going to stay with the data, but the data is pretty clear that he's made it abundantly clear that he doesn't think inflation is going to moderate in a structural sense back down to their 2% target, which nobody in this room should agree with, but those are the rules of the game.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Whereas Krugman's out there saying he might have to go to 3 or 4% or whatever. I mean, it's just nonsense. Until 2025. Until the middle of 2025, we're not going to get back to a structural, you know, underlying level of inflation that is 2% until the middle of 2025. So if you understand
why 25?
Well, I think that's what he says. I mean, that's what he's saying. I don't know. Okay. It could be 2026. It could be 20. He may be wrong about that, but it's certainly not going to be 2024. And the reason for this is, I was writing about this the other day for my patrons, and the easiest way to model what I'm thinking is think ripples in a pond. Okay, you drop a rock into a pond and you get ripples, and you get a wave. You get a decaying wave of ripples. Right. The first ripple that's out from the rock is the tallest, and then the next one after that, that's what's called a dampening oscillation, right? And if you look at it, you know, as a sound wave, it's a dampening oscillation. Anybody's ever looked at a vocal track in Audacity knows exactly what I'm talking about. So I want you to think of it in those terms, okay? COVID was the rock in the pond. Last year's inflation was the first round of commodity cost push inflation due to the disruption of supply chains and the disruption of the general economy.
Right.
And then we hit the trough. We're in the trough now. Energy prices are starting to rise again. Commodity prices are starting to rise. The labor market is still dislocated. Supply chains things are still browning out all over the economy as capital tries to reorganize. And into that, Powell raised interest rates 5.5% in 15 months.
Yeah.
So, but that is, again, is about credit demand tamping, you know, trying to dampen down the oscillations in credit demand,
right?
Which is a different form of inflation than commodity cost push inflation. So these two things don't really, you know, jive. The monetary policy stuff is about wringing the excess credit-based leverage out of the global dollar-based system. The inflation that Powell knows he can't fight and just has to ride out the various waves of is in the commodity sector.
Interesting.
And for that reason, this is why he's been very, very, very clear. I'm not going to pivot. I'm not going, and if inflation returns at all, I am not going to encourage credit markets to think that I'm going to go back down to 4% or 3% or whatever. I'm going to keep credit markets tight as possible because we have to wring out as much of this leverage as possible. We have to undo the damage of 13 years worth of ZERP and ZERP, zero bound interest rate policy and negative interest rate policy. We have to get rid of all that. Do you understand how many trillions of dollars globally, how our colossally, if not drastically, horrifically mispriced?
Of course, yeah.
If you don't, I give you
hundreds of trillions.
I give you 2.5% on the German 10-year. Right. I give you 4.25% on the Italian 10-year. Anybody who thinks that Italian BTP, a 10-year Italian BTP, should be trading at 4.25% should have his head examined. It should be trading at 14.25% in any rational collateral-based world.
Yeah. No, I agree. So,
And I think that's the thing that everybody's wrestling with. And everybody's trying to be right as to when Powell's going to pivot because they want to be the next guy to be right so that they can sell subscriptions or whatever. I don't give a shit about being right. I care about being right. I don't care about subscriptions. If I'm right, they take care of themselves. If I'm wrong, exactly. And I admit that I'm wrong, they also take care of themselves. That's
right.
Fine. This is not about my ego. This is about what's happening, even though my ego is colossal.
Why do you think why do you think that they waited so long to well, first off, I don't remember, when did Jerome Powell take Fed chair position? Do you know the year?
Yeah, it was in 2017.
Right? Okay.
Yeah.
And he didn't begin this hiking process until
late 2017. Yeah.
Yeah, until 22. So he was in there for 5 years with essentially ZIRP.
Well,
go ahead. Seems like you have commentary already.
So Yellen started to raise rates right before she left, and she put it off for a year and a half because she was never intended to raise rates. Powell started to raise rates, and in 2019 had to go back down because that's when the market broke. We got the repo crisis in September 2019. Miraculously, 6 months later, we got COVID.
Yeah,
when he was going to start raising rates again back in March.
Let's expand upon that because this has been a thesis that a lot of people have had that perhaps the COVID, which I think most people are willing to acknowledge was created in the Wuhan Institute of Virology, and whether or not it was leaked intentionally granted, Fauci and EcoHealth Alliance through NIH was funding that research. Are we of the belief that this was intentional, or was it just capitalized upon to get him to reverse course in terms of the interest rate hiking cycle? Like, I don't know.
I firmly believe that, and I've been saying this for over 2 years now, that like COVID was the means by which to ensure that Powell never got back off the negative bound or the zero bound. And I've tried to explain this in ways to make people to get it, in that the reason in the past that Powell's had to pivot when the banking sector got into trouble, okay, was because of the debt indexing issues, right? We were still on a international focused debt indexing rate known as LIBOR, London Interbank Offer Rate. LIBOR is set by 17 out of 18 London-based banks and pretty much cares about the euro dollar system, what's known as the offshore dollar system. And that's where LIBOR is focused. It doesn't care about the American banking system. Okay. What it does, but any pain that exists in the offshore dollar system gets translated on when everybody's writing their mortgages and their credit revolvers and their credit card debt and everything else are all based in their HELOCs, are all based on LIBOR.
Right.
The European banks get into trouble, for example, then the American banks have to, they functionally as a just contract. This is just basic contract law.
Sure.
Your mortgage is LIBOR, your adjustable rate mortgage is LIBOR plus 3.5%. If LIBOR blows out to 7%, your mortgage goes up to 10.5%. It's programmatic. It doesn't matter whether your bank is in trouble or not. It doesn't matter whether your bank has an impaired balance sheet or not, or its Texas ratio is good, bad, or indifferent. It doesn't matter. It goes up. And so when that happens, that forces the Fed back to pivot. Back to lower and lower rates. And that's the history of the dollar reserve standard going back to the 1950s. Is why Bretton Woods fell down. It's why Nixon had to close the gold window. It's why Volcker had to do what he did for a short period of time. And then from there, it was a big race to the bottom. Once we get to the bottom, you either stay there, which is what they've been arguing. Globalists, commies, do away with the private formation of capital by keeping everybody in entranced with bad ideas at the zero bound, where money is free, so leverage is infinite. Or we can start raising rates again. But in order to do that, you've got to decouple. The real decoupling is not the American economy from China, as the neocons would like us to believe, as the Mitt Romney bots and the inheritors of John McCain want us to believe. It has nothing to do with that. The real split has to do with the American banking system is now indexed to the secured overnight funding rate, which is a domestic rate collateralized by honest to God overnight transactions in the repo markets here in the United States. It has nothing to do with what's going on over in Europe. And I can tell you that I've been screamed at by people on Twitter. I've had dozens of emails sent to me. This was all part of the plan. And LIBOR was corrupt and they were getting rid of it. Like, no, this was never part of the plan. And if it was part of the plan, the whole purpose, it wasn't that LIBOR was going to be replaced with SOFR. The LIBOR was going to be replaced with something worse, like Euribor or whatever it was. Mm. And it was the introduction of SOFR by Powell after he was nominated and put in as Fed chair. And then John Williams was put in at the head of the very powerful, all-powerful New York Fed. Mm. That was done on a five-year rollout basis. And when the repo crisis of 2019 happened, the SOFR market wasn't mature because it hadn't been fully rolled out yet. Mm-hmm. Like, we were still switching everything over. By 2022, however, SOFR is now the law of the land for all new debt in the United States. The SOFR, and the blowout in volume on SOFR, the three-month SOFR futures contract, killed the Eurodollar futures contract in less than 12 months. By April of this year, well, by October of last year, the CME, the Chicago Mercantile Exchange, said, you know, put in practice, we will be ending Euro dollar futures contract trading because there's no volume left. It had been replaced by SOFR. And the Euro dollar system was, the Euro dollar futures contract was tied to LIBOR.
Mm-hmm.
SOFR killed LIBOR in 10 months once it was made the law of the land. So the Fed did its job. And then once that was in place, now when Powell started to raise rates, he didn't have to pivot.
Why? Got you.
Because we have
the contracts aren't
American banking system that is pricing risk far differently, and everybody else has to take their cues from us as opposed to us having to take our cues from them.
For
most of our lives and most of the life of the Libertarian Party and the modern American libertarian movement, we have lived under a Federal Reserve that was not in control of its own monetary policy. And yet the Fed took all of our opprobrium, rightfully as a general critique of central banking,
right,
but wrongfully based on the fact that it was the Fed is the most powerful one, but the Fed wasn't actually acting for us. The Eurodollar system as it has existed up until, well, frankly, 2021, was only capable of existing. And this is where I'll go toe-to-toe with Jeff Snyder any day of the week. I don't give a shit because he's wrong. That it was only ever right. It was only ever capable of sustaining itself as long as the Fed played along.
Mm.
You had to have a compliant Fed in order to make the system work. Well, once the Fed starts acting like the central bank of the United States as opposed to the central bank of the world, what a shock. Globalism runs into problems.
Yeah. So this is
papers over here, for fuck's sake. It's not that hard.
So, I mean, I think it's fair to say what you're describing is a financial 1776.
It's like a declaration of independence.
Yeah. The U.S. central banking institutions are declaring their independence from the European ones.
Yes.
And
look, remember, I've said this. I don't know, Clint, I've said this on so many podcasts. I know the people who watch me will roll their eyes. He's going to say it again. Look, the European colonies the European old colonial powers have wanted their colonies back since the day after Cornwallis surrendered to Yorktown.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, what was the War of 1812 about? Who created the Southern Secession? Who amplified and created the Southern, gaslit the Southerners into seceding in the quote unquote recent unpleasantness, otherwise known as the American Civil War, otherwise known as Lincoln's War to save Northern Railroad bankers from themselves. Whatever you want to call it. Everybody's got a name for it. We get down here in the South call it the recent unpleasantness. So, I mean, call it, there's 18 different ways to look at the U.S. quote unquote Civil War, which was nothing of the sort, obviously. It was a war of secession.
Mm-hmm.
But one of them was that it was yet another, you know, British false flag operation to break the country up, to break the U.S. up in order to get their colonies back. And so from that perspective, even though I'm a good Floridian now and I say, yep, Lincoln was a tyrant, I'm also like, yeah, but.
Interesting.
And, that, you know.
That is fascinating to think about. Yeah.
And it's hard to think about because Lincoln is excoriated within the libertarian community, and you're not wrong to do so on points of philosophy, but on points of practicality in the geopolitical milieu of the world you live, not the world you want. history is never quite that simple.
Yeah, it's more complicated than it, you know, just a philosophical analysis. That's fascinating. I had never really considered it in that lens. So I'll have to.
I had to sit down and I had to like have a real long look in the mirror on this one.
Yeah. I mean, well, I would imagine. I mean, it's the bloodiest. I think it may have been the bloodiest war in human history at the time, if not, yes. I mean, certainly the bloodiest civil war, 600,000 plus dead. It's insane. So,
it was a high price.
Right.
And you know damn well that the British aristocracy was sitting there back on like Mr. Burns going, excellent. What do you call 500,000 dead Americans fighting over swampland in South Carolina? Right. A good start. Look what's happening in Ukraine. Yeah, what do you call 300,000 dead Slavs fighting over swampland in southern Ukraine? Again, same people, same reaction. A good start. These people are evil, dude.
Yeah,
and
I agree.
To realize that sometimes the order of operations and how we extricate ourselves from their control matters. Never lose sight of the prize. We want liberty, but understand that how you get there matters. And just walking in and, you know, like a bunch of 17-year-old boys going, just tear it all down.
Yeah.
No. All you're doing is feeding the beast at that point, because these people are goading you into it. They're literally goading us into civil war in this country. And I'm telling everybody over and over again, don't be gaslit by morons. They're literally trying to gaslight you into a war for secession again 150 years later. Don't do it. Don't fall for it. We will subjugate California. We will subjugate Washington. We will subjugate New York. Or they can leave.
Right.
They can leave. And then we're going to say, you know what? No, we already fought one of these wars. You get to stay. And you get to take our rules, California, as opposed to you getting your orders from fucking Klaus Schwab and then trying to export them to the rest of us. Oh, by the way, that's why the fight over the Fed is so interesting. Because it's literally the New York Fed fighting the San Francisco Fed. And that's Janet Yellen's bailiwick, babe. That's all those banks that failed earlier in the year. Silicon Valley, they're all San Francisco banks. By the way, they were all bought by a New York bank.
Mm.
Every one of them. All their bad assets were written down to zero and all their good assets were transferred to New York banks. Point Powell.
Yeah,
that's like Bernard from the corner with a three-pointer, like, dude. If I'm channeling Marv Albert in an old Knicks blood, that's Bernard from the corner,
like from downtown.
Exactly. I even hate basketball, but you know, I'm trying to getting good with the homies here, I guess. I don't know.
Well, I'm a Lakers fan, so I can appreciate the metaphor. All right, so here's an interesting question for you. It seems to me, based off of my study of the origin story and implementation of the ESG DEI practices, it has come through the UN, come through the World Economic Forum, kind of been a European or non-American phenomenon to a large extent. Where I get confused, and I hope you can help me clear this up, the Federal Reserve and I don't know if it was the Federal Reserve, but certainly the federal government has turned towards BlackRock when it comes to their bailout programs during COVID. They've been they've had a very positive relationship with BlackRock. BlackRock has been probably, if not almost certainly, the biggest proponent of ESG on the global financial market. So why? Why would they have a good relationship with BlackRock, given that they seem to be propagating what I would imagine Powell and company would be in opposition towards, which is this shame economy?
Well, have you noticed that BlackRock is now trying to divest itself of ESG?
I've heard them giving lip service to it. I don't know if it's true, but yes.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot happening here where nothing turns on a dime like this, right? Larry Fink, I remember when I first started this, I remember people saying to me, your fault. Powell met with Larry Fink 8 times in the last 12 months. I'm like, And why do you believe that it was Larry Fink making Jerome Powell kiss the ring?
You think it's the other way around?
Why don't you, excuse me, but you know, why do you think it's, if DEI and ESG are such good ideas, they're able to survive 5.5% interest rates then, aren't they?
Yeah,
They're not. And that's the point. Like the proof is in the policy. It's in the actions that have been taken. And so the policy is very simply, I'm just going to flip the script on you and ask you the question, why do you believe that Powell would be genuflecting the Larry freaking think? When I got news for you, having talked to Danielle DiMartino Booth about this, I brought this up to her when I had her on my podcast. And she said, oh, by the way, Fink has no friends left on Wall Street because he's betrayed them all. Every single one of them.
In terms of bucking ESG or in going along with it?
In terms of doing what the WEF has wanted and undermining corporate boards and undermining this and voting our proxies and everything else. Fink can't get anybody on the phone anymore.
Oh, that's fucking great to hear.
Oh, yeah, no, absolutely. Like BlackRock, I brought it up to Danielle, I said, you know, Danielle, I did a quick balance sheet analysis of, and she just started to, the minute I started to do this, she's like a big smile on her face. I didn't keep the video, but she started to smile a little bit and because she knew exactly where I was going with this. So Danielle, you know, I kind of went through BlackRock's balance sheet, you know, just on a lark. Because I remember Martin Armstrong said something about BlackRock being in trouble. You know, about a year and a half ago, he like put up his 51. He put up his cycle on analysis on BlackRock. He said, you should target BlackRock. He said, look at it. They may be at the peak of their power. I'm like, all right, I'll throw. So about 3 months later, I'm like, I sat down for a market report for my patrons one morning. I said, you know, let's just kind of sit down and look at BlackRock. I went through and did a balance sheet analysis of BlackRock. And I started stripping out all the bullshit and the fluff from their balance sheet. And I went, they don't have any shareholder equity. And she's like, mm-hmm. I said, this entire big pile of power that they supposedly have, when you strip out like goodwill and intangibles and other bullshit from their balance sheet, and then like any good bank at this point, you can't even figure out what their actual equity is because there's an other liabilities line item that varies anywhere from $30 to $40 billion a quarter.
Wow.
And that's on when you strip out goodwill and tangibles, there's only $8 billion left on the balance sheet. They're a hedge fund. Or they're a fund manager. That's all they are. They don't actually make any money. And they have a side consulting business, but that's all WEF stuff because they've inserted their people into the court and by voting our proxy into the corporate boards of all these companies that are miraculously all self-immolating, like InBev and Disney and all these companies that we now all hate because they, you know, turned Snow White into a, you know, black chick and, you know, and fucked with my Star Wars, man. Like not that I might even buy that argument, but like, you know what I mean? Like, remember, like, this is the thing I got to get everybody on board with here. BlackRock was absolutely freaking evil. And these Davos motherfuckers also control the purse strings that which projects get funded and which ones don't. Hollywood runs on debt, dude. Like, if you're angry about, you know, the way things are happening with your various things that you love, be it Star Wars or this or that, whatever it is.
Sure.
Right. Realize that if the script isn't sufficiently woke, then Disney can't get the freaking loan.
Oh yeah, no, I know.
Right. So this is the reality.
It's not necessarily their desire to continue to do this. It's kind of like, well, do you want the funding for the fucking project or don't you?
Yeah, well, it gets even worse than that. When BlackRock is putting their thumb on the scale, and then it's the same thing with, like, I get people yelling at me all the time, like, why are you on Patreon, dude? Like, they censor and blah, 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 blah. Mm-hmm. I'll gladly give you money otherwise. I'm like, do you realize that how many times that Patreon was probably as a company with 47 people or something like that and a revenue stream of, like, $5 million or $5 or $6 million? Do you think Patreon has any real power?
Yeah, no.
Do you think Patreon was the one sitting there putting the thumb, you know, getting rid of Sargon of Akkad and Jordan Peterson, the rest of them? No. I mean, sure. So much of this is they get the opprobrium from us because we're angry at what they've done, but they didn't have any choice.
Yeah. They're reacting to the top-down pressure.
Right. And that pressure is real. It's everywhere. It's pervasive and it's everywhere. And now when you see it coming from something like someone like BOFA, Bank of America, and they're like, you know, denying, you know, shutting down accounts to gun dealers, that like BOFA, no, BOFA glows, dude. Like they're so freaking Davos, it's not funny, right? But when it comes to when it comes to this stuff, and then worse than this is the other thing you have to realize. I can sit here and do another hour, and we can go through like the different factions that are fighting amongst themselves, let's say the top of the American government, or what's happening in Ukraine, and I can do all the factional analysis and pull up my board game metaphors that I always do and go, look, if you're the Atreides and you're the Harkonnens, you're going to get the Guild and the Emperor to fight themselves in order to come in and take over the spoils, right, if we're making a Dune metaphor. But the reality is that that's happening within every one of these companies.
Yeah.
Okay. For example, Mary Erdos over at JP Morgan, her and Jess Staley were the ones that were handling Jeffrey Epstein's accounts. Okay. Jamie Dimon had no idea what was going on. This isn't Jamie Dimon's job. Jeffrey Epstein is worth what? $500 million? Like, or at most. And you could even argue that he was ever worth that much money in liquid cash that JP Morgan would have access to. The guy was worth maybe what, $30 to $40 million?
Right. Now, like, it doesn't rise to the level of Jamie Dimon's analysis,
for fuck's sake.
Yeah,
that
of course.
That guy has no ability to even get into a room with Dimon. Yeah. So, but Dimon is going to be, as the CEO, is going to be the point man on this. So when the Epstein lawsuit comes out against Dimon in Puerto Rico with an Obama judge, what a shock. Like, how many in this community, in the libertarian community, fell for the whole Epstein, Dimon angle, as opposed to saying, oh, come on, this is Davos Nuts and Sluts 101, guys. Like, you cannot see this?
I've never heard that.
You've never heard me use the term nuts and sluts before. I can't take credit for it. I think the Raging Cajun, it was an old comment. He came up with it ages ago. But yeah, it's all nuts and sluts, right? Whenever they want to get rid of somebody, it's either, you know, they're a sexual deviant or they're crazy.
Right.
Right? It's just that simple. So we can go all the way back to Dominique Strauss-Kahn. Like, I was supposed to be upset that when he was the head of the IMF and they wanted to replace him with Christine Lagarde. I'm like, I'm supposed to be upset that he banged a hot French maid?
Yeah.
Like, really? I'm supposed to be upset about this?
Yeah,
like,
no, that never rises to the level of my doesn't get my cankles up.
It would be one thing if you know, he banged an ugly French maid. That'd be one thing. But this chick was hot. Like, come on, man. I mean, if it was Christine Lagarde that he banged, I'd go, like, oh, all right, you are both a nut and a slut. But
get this guy out of here. Well, I wanted to ask you about the presidential race. I'm curious if there are, is Donald Trump aware of this fight? Is there any, like, is Vivek Ramaswamy the real deal, or is he an insider, you know, wolf in sheep's clothing? Are there any presidential options that are legit contenders, which I'd say there's maybe four that actually know what the hell's going on?
Okay, so let's start with Vivek Ramaswamy. Ready? You get this one first, dude. He's H-1B Obama. Okay, let's just, that's it. Hashtag H-1B Obama. Like, that's who he is. And if you think otherwise, like, his company doesn't make any money. He went to Yale. He took money from Soros. Yeah, he sued the WEF and won. Okay. You know, come on. Like, he's Rishi Sunak. He's Rishi Sunak 2.0. Yeah. Trump, on the other hand, he does understand some of what's going on here. But remember, Trump also has many, many, many personal defects as a human being, and likes debt, and still doesn't like Powell for undermining his recovery by doing, you know, that he his plan to remake America into a mercantilist power, a la the, you know, basically to do the British Empire thing here in the United States. And Powell was like, oh no, we're not doing that either. Mm-hmm. Like, that got us into the trouble we're in today. We're not doing that either. And he was very, so to this day, like, none of them get it. They all want to get rid of Powell because they all are politicians that want the return to the zero balance so they can spend money on their projects.
Right.
That has not changed.
Yeah.
And the only one who's politically actually talking about austerity is Robert F. Kennedy Jr.
Yeah. Which is interesting. Because well, it's interesting to me because you don't usually expect the Democrat side of the aisle to be the one that's talking austerity in any regard. Do you think he's sincere?
Yeah, but he's not really a Democrat. He's not a modern Democrat, Clinton.
No, of course.
Of course not. He's like his uncle.
Right.
Right.
Right. Right.
Today, John F. Kennedy Jr. would be, he would be literally Irish Hitler. or sorry, Catholic Hitler, because he was, remember, it was a big deal that he was Catholic.
Yeah, remember, I forget that. Yeah.
Even Ike wasn't. I remember this one from high school that, you know, we talked about this. I remember this is, you know, we actually did social studies in American government class back then, saying that Ike was an atheist.
Hmm.
And they're like, well, you can't run for president and be an atheist. So the joke was that they made him write down Presbyterian, because that's like not really being anything anyway. Right. They're no offense to the Presbyterians in the audience, but I was raised Catholic. You know, I'm neither any of that stuff anymore, but it's just funny. It was just funny. It's
quick
a funny
follow
story.
Up. Quick follow up on Vivek, because I've had him on the show. You know, he's a very impressive guy, incredibly gifted politician and speaker.
I agree.
I even said in my post show after the interview with him that I just can't believe he's this good. You know, like that was my takeaway, because
I got H-1B Obama or low rent Ron Paul. Like again, I am happy to be wrong about this. I don't buy it. I think that, you know, he's straight from central casting.
Quick question, okay, though, because I know he was listed as a young global leader. He alleges that categorization was done without any sort of tests, or, you know, he didn't go to some school and get right. schooled up on how to become this speaker or any of this stuff. That his rhetoric, what blows me away is not the scripted speeches that you could expect Obama or anybody else to give, where they actually have cuts and he can work on it. I saw him doing Q&As with the audience, and he responds with such a devastating blow to the DEI ESG framework.
Sure.
And you know, basically describes it, as I said earlier, about like how this is our own economic 1776. And it's just hard to fake. You know what I mean? Like, it's just really hard to fake that level of understanding and then pivot and make it sound appealing to people like you and I. Like, how the fuck is he doing
this? But you see, all that stuff is irrelevant when he gets to foreign policy.
Yeah.
Because foreign policy is indistinguishable
like
from everybody else on the Republican stage.
Yeah.
I mean, well, there's a great meme going around Ukraine. Him arguing with Nimrata. And, look, it's two Indians arguing over how much money we should be sending to Israel.
I know that I was very disappointed to see that. And then he came out yesterday and said, you know, Taiwan, I'm the only candidate on the Republican side that's willing to say I will militarily defend Taiwan. And I'm like, oh, fuck, here we go.
Yeah, yeah, no, that's exactly right. They'll always get, this is the thing, they'll always get you with what you want to hear on one side of the equation, and then remind you. So Vivek is absolutely straight from central casting from the British side of the equation. That was what I was just about to get to. Like I said, I'm not kidding when I say Rishi Sunak 2.0. There's a very, one of the interesting things geopolitically is the role of India, right? And I'm not going to go into very deep on this, but one of the things we've been bandying around within my community privately has been the role of India, and how India seems to be the, of all the BRICS nations, and now BRICS plus six, the ones, you know, with a foot on both islands, both in the East and in the West at the same time, right? Modi has always, you know, Prime Minister Narendra Modi has always played, you know, everybody off against each other. And that's fine. That's the best way, of course, to get the most from both sides, right? Erdogan over in Turkey is a master at this. But at the same time, one of the things that was brought up to me, both from some members of my community who are Westerners, but also from who are of Indian extraction, they said the same thing, which is that there's a lot of the Indian aristocracy, and again, I'm using a very broad term here, and I know it's more complicated than this, sure, that were never happy with the British rule ending. That they, you know, there's still a lot of those people, and that's the vestiges of that are still very, very prevalent in Indian politics. And those individuals and those factions within Indian politics have a home in City of London and in MI6 and at 10 Downing Street. And you have to understand that the British, I know people get on my case about this and they think that the British are just a bunch of buffoons that make Monty Python, but they're not. They still have tremendous influence, and they're using every ounce of what they have left to in order to maintain their position at this point. And so I look at a guy like Vivek, and I look at Sunak, and I look at the rest of them. I'm not saying that Vivek is WEF. This gets into this factional thing. It's clear that there's a British faction within the WEF. There's also a clear British, US, Polish, neoconservative, kill all freaking Russians faction. Kill all Chinese faction. That's the Victoria Nuland faction. That's that, you know, for lack of a better term, the Khazari mafia thing. That's the Ukrainian diaspora and all of that stuff. So
Robert
those
Kagan.
Are not the same factions. They want war. They understand that the only way they're going to maintain their, with the vestiges of their empire, is to fight a global war against, you know, the dirty Slavs and the dirty Chinese. Whereas the WEFers think that they can do this from the top down and and protect their fortress Europe at the same time. And if anything that assails their fortress Europe, that's what gets the WEF's real ire. That's why Powell is their bad guy. But at the same time, you have, you know, you have this, you have these neoconservatives that are, and these freaking warmongers, that they're not the same people. And in many ways, the WEF has always, Davos, whatever you want to call them, have manipulated, you know, the neocons into doing their bidding by getting the United States to do dumb shit around the world, blowing up brown people and invading them for, you know, looking at us cross-eyed and all the rest of it. This is
It's not hard to get them to do that.
And it's not. They're the easiest people in the world to manipulate. Oh, you want us to go kill Russians?
Right.
Iranians? Okay, cool. And then they, you know, they bring John Bolton out and they put him on national television and they give him an audience. Like, it's not hard. Okay. So understand that so much of this is, it's not one big club. It's factions within the big club, and they're all fighting amongst themselves. And I look at Vivek and I say, oh, he's clearly the British Raj.
Well,
faction. And here's you know, the same thing with Nimrata, and the same thing with, you know, Sunak and all the rest of them. And they're everywhere. Well, and you go look, they're all of a sudden Indian beta males are everywhere in politics. It's kind of like German women. The factional splits are, it's almost clear you can just define it that way. So
it seems counter to your thesis that Vivek, I mean, it could just be lip service, granted, but the fact that he has made his antagonism towards the World Economic Forum, and but more specifically, he spent years advocating against ESG. Do you think he's sincere in that, at least?
Oh, sure. Because I can see, because look at it this way. These people are, the neocons don't care about, the neocons are smart enough to realize that you need a collateral-based economy.
Okay.
They understand.
So they're in the Powell camp. Interesting.
In that respect,
right.
Yes. But it's not, but again, Powell's on his own, Powell's a different faction altogether. Okay.
Sure.
But
sure.
They have, again, it's like a Venn diagram of shifting alliances, and there's at least three or four factions, and at times they overlap in various ways. And then the game board changes a little bit, because what's clear, what's happening now, is that the WEF is trying to make us believe that we don't need collateral to run a monetary system. So that's why the push towards DEI and ESG as a governing principle. And so from that perspective, if Vivek is a neocon, or at least attached with the British Raj, you know, faction of global fuckers who want to control everything, at the very least, then they understand that you can't do this without oil. So they're the ones that, you know, yeah, they want to open up the British North Slope and sell that back to Europe. And, you know, they're the, and they'll back Brexit on one day and then they won't back Brexit on the next day. Like, this is the way this works. Everything for them is a tactic. How do I get to Russia? Because they need all of Russia's collateral, right? And that collateral is the oil, the gas, the uranium, the this, the, all of it. They want it all. And they understand that the Russians are the only other, and they've known, understood this for 300 years, and it's been part of British foreign policy for 300 years. And I went over this in a two-hour podcast I did with Richard Poe on my podcast a couple of months ago, and he went into some of this, just some of it. I could have easily have Richard on for another 6 hours and talk about this stuff. But the British have understood that the only other empire that was their rival was the Russians. And so the Russians had to be killed. And for the British Empire to and even the vestiges of it to survive into the end of the 21st century, it's to get rid of the Russians. Because if you get rid of the Russians, then the entire BRICS and Global South will then fall back under, in their thinking, will fall back under their spell. But if you look at what happened with the BRICS summit this week or last week, it wasn't the gold-backed trade settlement currency and all that. That was all bullshit. That's coming, but that's 5, 7, 8 years from now. That's going to happen bit by bit. What was really important were the 6 freaking countries that they added. Now, we always knew they were going to add Iran, because the I in BRICS has been Iran for a long time now, for all intents and purposes. Again, go back to the whole India not wanting to commit to either side. And into that, Russia and China have been building up Iran, and they put hundreds of billions of dollars into Iran. Iran, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Ethiopia, the UAE, that's Dubai and Abu Dhabi, and then Argentina. But focus on the first 5. And
that's a shitload of natural resources.
It's not just a shitload of natural resources. It's everything you need to build a gold and logistical and oil supply chain financially in the Middle East. It's already being built. It's already happening in Abu Dhabi and Dubai. That's why the UAE is so important. Okay. Again, did a great podcast with on Palisades Gold Radio with Vince Lanchi, where Vince and I go over all of this stuff, talking about you in order to move a market from one locality to another. And this lets us talk about the gold trade. In order for that to happen, you have to build the entire infrastructure around gold trading in that area. It means you have to have vaults, and you got to have clearinghouses, and you got to have exchanges, and you got to have currency exchange rates, and you got to have the banks, and you got to have this, and you got to have all of these things, and you got to have the logistics to move this up around, blah, 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 blah. All that has to get built over time. And so China has that in Hong Kong. They have it in Singapore. Okay. They're building it in Dubai. It's almost practically built in Dubai. The Russians are now wanting to build the same systems in Moscow. Okay. And that bleeds and that will eventually bleed the volumes off of the manipulated exchanges in London, Zurich, and Chicago. And it'll move there. So you can't have a multi-currency trade settlement currency system like they're talking about. And again, it will be just trade settlement. It will not be, you know, building up each other's reserves. It's the same system. It'll be an old mercantilist system of gold will move around from account to account and deal with each other's trade imbalances. But that's it.
Yeah. Well,
and that'll get digitized. But you have, in order for that to happen, you have to have the whole infrastructure built.
Right.
And that's
going to take time.
And that's going to take time. And so we add Iran, Saudi Arabia, now Egypt. Now you've got Ethiopia. Once you've got the Russians with port access in both Djibouti and Eritrea. So now, and with the end, with Saudi Arabia and Iran opening up, normalizing relations and opening up embassies with each other, and the war in Yemen is now ended. Oh, look, Putin ended the war in Yemen. Practically ended the war in Syria. Now we have the BRICS in control of the BRICS, not the British. The BRICS in control of the Suez Canal and the Gulf of Aden at the bottom of the Red Sea.
Wow.
And now you've got Bandar Abbas, the port of Chabahar in the south of Iran, outside of the Persian Gulf. Now all of a sudden, U.S. naval positions in that area are more than we have the ability to handle, which is now start looking at how the Chinese are going to build up Myanmar in order to be a port north of the Straits of Malacca, where so Singapore isn't as important and the Straits of Malacca aren't as important. I'm telling you, this is all part of their plan, and you can see it all happening.
Yeah, no, that's a fascinating analysis of it, and a very, very eagle eye to see all of that.
And they're just very simply going ahead with their plans. Sure. And then a month earlier, Putin has 30 African nation leaders in St. Petersburg or Moscow. And amazingly enough, 5 days later, Niger says to France, oh, yeah, we're calling your bluff as to whether or not you're going to invade us or not. Yeah. If Niger, for example, imagine if the French actually go to Niger. to try and oust the junta. With as angry as Africans are at the French, no matter how good the French Foreign Legion is and the French military is, and don't in any way, manner, shape, or form fall for the neoconservative cheese-eating surrender monkey bullshit.
Right,
the
right,
French
right.
are good at war.
Oh, yeah.
And the French Foreign Legion, this is, I'll put them up against Wagner Group or any Russian mercenaries or Blackwater or anybody else in the world. They're good. But they go in against a hostile population that is looking to kill Frenchmen. They're all going to get heads on pikes.
Yeah, it's going to be ugly. I agree. Do you think, I mean, it was also the folks in Niger, I forget who it was, but he told Victoria Nuland to go on a diet or something like that. I was like, damn, dude, you're telling War Hawk Empress she needs to go on a diet.
So Karen Nuland,
these dudes are ready for war.
In Niger to speak to the manager. I want to talk to the manager. Oh
my God. They were not having any of that.
Like, he's like, yeah. Why don't you go fuck yourself? And we'll call it even.
Oh, exactly,
God,
dude.
Now you got me going. I'm doing accents. Badass.
I loved it though. It made me very happy to hear anybody tell Victoria Nuland to kick rocks because you know wherever she goes, she's the Grim Reaper of neoconservative foreign policy. Like that, there's probably some sort of invasion or at least financial armaments and shit that are coming in. So yeah, like, that was interesting.
She went to South Africa right before the it wasn't before the BRICS summit. It was before the it was another moment.
Yeah, I remember. Yeah,
and she went down to South Africa to scold them in July, and
right.
and they all told her to go fuck herself. So then she had to go run over to Niger, and then they slammed the door in her face. Like it was a sight to behold. And then
I think people are starting to catch on.
Yeah, but at the same time, like then Prigozhin gets downed in a plane crash a few days later, and you're saying to yourself, okay, yeah, because like this is.
You think that was U.S.?
I don't know who it was, but okay. I can make an argument. Like at this point, Prigozhin's death feels like the end of Act One in a Hercule Poirot movie, where you're looking around and there's 12 people, and they all have a good alibi. They all have a good MO for killing this guy.
Right.
Putin, the Americans, the British, this one. Everybody's got an angle. Right. I could sit here for half an hour and spin out tall tales off the top of my head, and they'd all be reasonably valid. So I'm not going to do so. What I'm going to say is,
I have no clue.
Everybody had a
reason. Yeah. Well, I think a lot of people were thinking that perhaps the alleged coup by Prigozhin was an effort via Putin or a directed effort by Putin to basically mislead so that he could reorient troops during the counteroffensives from the Ukrainians. And if that's the case, then I could see an argument that it would be the U.S. or the Brits that wanted to see Prigozhin taken out. Plus, it has the double incentive of, hey, now this look how bloodthirsty Putin is. He took out his mercenary. now we care about mercenaries.
Yeah, but not only taking out Prigozhin, you took out like three or four of the top leaders in Wagner. And so Wagner was making noises about going and supporting in this year. And, remember that the key to Nuland, understanding Nuland at this point is to understand the following. There was we've talked about I know everybody talked about the gas pipeline coming up from, through Niger up through, and then from there, I don't know my North African geography that well, and then up to Morocco or whatever, and then into Italy. The important thing is that the thing was going to go through there and into Italy. Okay, the Americans have 100 bases, or we Americans have over 100 bases in Italy. Okay,
wow,
Italy is incredibly important, and Giorgia Meloni, the current supposedly. Betraying a center right wing populist from the Brothers of Italy. Again, she's in a very difficult position as well. She's being betrayed on all sides. If you think the American deep state is evil, well, God knows that they learned it from the Italians.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Italian deep state mafia shit is hundreds of years old. She's got them, she's got the EU, and she's got the Americans. So look, in order to keep Maloney on side with the, look, why would Nuland want to blow up Nord Stream in order to make things terrible for the Germans? Because, well, you think the deal was blow up Nord. I mean, this is part of it. Blow up Nord Stream, and we're going to bring in an oil pipeline in through Italy, and we're going to produce, and we're going to pump up the Italians at the expense of the Germans. Okay, because we have a big, and as an Italian, I'm like, yes, absolutely, all day, every day, please. Like, right. no love lost between Italians and Germans, folks, and I mean that with love. But at the same time, Maloney is trying to stay in power as much as possible. And the only way she stays in power is by having the U.S. military on her side.
Mm.
So this is why she has given lip service to supporting Ukraine. But then she sends a whole bunch of Italian, you know, it's like the joke about the old Italian submarines. You know, how do you sink an Italian submarine? You either open up the screen doors, you put it in water, right? Well, it's the same thing with Italian fighting vehicles and their rifles and all the rest of it. Like, she sent them their junk.
Right.
Like, this is the stuff even the Italians were like, oh, that was a bad idea. Here you go. You can have some of those. Like,
she
sent stuff that didn't work. She dragged her feet about everything. And this is that was your tell that Maloney is trying as best as possible to keep everybody, to keep all the balls juggled, all the balls in the air until somebody finally gets control over the situation in Europe. And she's just trying to outlast the crazy. And then when somebody's finally drops a ball,
right?
That's when she can make her move.
Gotcha.
That's when it will be the Bank of Italy and the Italians who say, you know what? I'm out of the EU. And she doesn't get a chance to do that if she doesn't have the American military on her side. And I'm sure Victoria Nuland has, and the State Department has told her, well, then in order for that to happen, she needs to have more gas coming in from North Africa. Putin's probably would be willing to tell her the same thing, but she can't take, she has to, I mean, it's like she's got devils in both, on both sides of her. You have to pick a choice between one terrible devil versus the other. And frankly, in this case, you got to pick the neocon devil because it's slightly better than the unbelievable German communists who just want to steal all of the physical infrastructure of Italy and put it under, you know, basically WEF control, because we all can see what they did to the Greeks back in 2015.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Where they sold all of Greece's, you know, infrastructure assets and trade assets to the Germans in order to get debt restructuring.
Right.
Yeah, that's what they did.
I know.
The Italians are not going along with that. That's not going to happen. So
that makes sense. Well, this is kind of off board, but I very, very much want to ask it because, you know, I recently read Scott Horton's new book, which isn't even released yet, called Provoked, and it gives this entire, you know, 30 year history of the fall of the USSR all the way up to present day, and how this war in Ukraine was very evidently provoked, and many in the State Department and American politics were very open about their concerns about the expansion of NATO and how this was inevitably going to come down to this showdown. What I found interesting and what I wasn't aware of until I read it was that both Yeltsin and Putin had asked repeatedly to be added to NATO, and that Putin in particular was like, what do I have to do? You know, like, I'm trying to fucking work with you guys. We ended the Warsaw Pact. Like, we're doing all of these things as signs of good faith. Can we just stop being perennial enemies? Why is it, and this is my question for you, why is it that even the European banking cartel, the families there, the World Economic Forum, the Davos crowd, why is it that it must be one of conquest as opposed to participation with the Russians? I've never really understood it. Do you know why?
Because the Russians want to, the price for the Russians is that they get to keep their culture.
And that's not acceptable.
That is not acceptable.
Wow.
Because culture, if they retain their culture, eventually they will not submit.
Interesting.
It will not be a permanent arrangement, and they know this.
So it requires conquest.
It requires conquest. It requires the destruction of all. That's if they look at their philosophy. Their philosophy is one of, we must destroy borders. We must destroy culture.
Right.
It is our different cultures and our sovereign and the various tribalism of Europe that created all the wars, and we're gonna create the new Soviet man.
Mm-hmm.
It's that simple. And then there's a lot of other stuff. And sure.
Very complicated.
I purposefully do not speak of the elephant in the room on purpose. So if you think that's me cucking out, fine. I'll wear it like a badge of honor, because at least I'll be able to come on and talk about it, talk about something else another day. So it's, you know, fill in the blanks with however it is you want to deal with any of this stuff. But it's also that it's only an angle on this.
Yeah, yeah.
The thing I got to get everybody to realize is that that 800-pound gorilla in the room, you know, what Dave Chappelle called the two words in the English language you're not allowed to put together next to each other, right? It's only one angle on this.
It's very multifaceted. Yeah.
It's a very powerful angle, because it is about people who have no ability to forgive.
Mm. Interesting.
Okay. And I'm not, again, and that's not all, that's not even close to an Axalt argument. It's a very, very small, particular group of people that have now, and I don't even want to, and the worst part about all this is that as a people, they're the ones that are going to wind up in the same place they were in the 1930s and 1940s if they don't stop it. Well, and this is not where Victoria Nuland has got to get over herself and stop trying to avenge the death of her, you know, trying to avenge her Ukrainian grandfather.
Yeah. Like, how many people have to die, Vicky? Good
right,
God.
How many people have to die for her friggin', for her, you know, for what she needs therapy for?
Well, like, what's the Chinese role here? I mean, China seems to be having pretty significant economic and debt issues itself.
Sure.
Do you think that they seem kind of like Italy to me, where they're kind of like trying to find the equilibrium? Is that their position?
I think so. I think Jamie Dimon made it abundantly clear to everybody: we're not going to decouple from China, and anybody who thinks that we're going to is an idiot. And that oil is going to be with us for the next 50 years. If you want my pick for Secretary of State in the Trump administration, part two, it should be Jamie Dimon, because he's been the most effective diplomat next to Tucker Carlson we have. Because Dimon goes overseas and gets world leaders in the room with him, and then speaks clarity and truth,
right? And people listen to
why
him
they
too.
Why they went after him,
because
he went to Davos this year and he said those words.
Yep. No, and that was, and that's completely antagonistic to the fucking
Davos
crowd.
Like walking in the room
crowd
and saying, "I'm sorry for farting." But you know, but I'm lactose intolerant, and I hit the Dairy Queen on my way in.
Saying that we're going to be on oil for the next 50 years and that we're going to stay working with China is like walking into the Davos room, getting up on the center of the table, taking your pants down, and shitting in the middle of the fucking room.
Exactly.
Like, it's crazy.
Like, I'm sorry. And then can I borrow your napkin, please? I need to wipe my ass. Like, and not even be shameful about it. Like, I need your napkin.
Because that is completely counter to everything that they.
And I'm not even going to get into German Scheiße porn. Okay, and that was terrible. So I shouldn't have done that one. My partner's going to be mad at me about that. But tough. So yes, that's exactly it. And so China's. I mean, I'm not as. I'm sympathetic to the view of many who view China as a real, you know, colonial threat, colonial style, you know, imperial threat. And it's in their history. But at the same time, I also think that the Chinese are, you know, opportunists. And all of these factional infighting, all this factional infighting that I'm talking about here, they're helping. Opportunistically, they're, you know.
Yeah.
You know, they're taking a pawn and moving it here and, you know, putting the black stone on the table
not
here
to.
And they're doing their thing. And then, and the Russians are going to help them because they have to. And they the Russians know, Putin knows that eventually in 50 years, he's going to have to deal with, or 40 years, he's going to have to deal with China.
Well, that's the crazy thing. The whole reason that Putin wanted to be added to NATO is because he's like, we are ethnically European. We are not Chinese. Don't push us into the arms of the Chinese. And they're like, fuck you, you're China now. It's like, it was just crazy.
And the Chinese and the Russians are going to have to deal with the Chinese at some point. And the Europeans are going to collapse. and it's going to be a dark age in Europe for, you know, a couple hundred years. And it is what it is. But, you know, what the Europeans are saying to everybody is that we're taking everybody with us.
Wow. Yeah, it does feel like
this is literally, some men just want to watch the world burn. So they're going to take the United States with, they need to take the United States with them. They're going to take every, and if they can take everybody with them, then at least we'll be at par and it'll be a de minimis zero kind of zero sum game. I'm dead serious, guys.
Communism.
This has been my read of the game board for a while now. And what I would say is this: guys like Powell and Diamond and others, I honestly think are sovereigntists. And I think Trump is a sovereigntist. I'm not advocating for Trump. I'm over Trump. If he winds up being the nominee or president or whatever, fine. It'll be at least entertaining. It'll probably still suck because, you know, because sequels are rarely better than the original. Right. And I'm just not expecting Donald Trump to be the Empire Strikes Back. I'm just not buying it.
Yeah.
So I don't know. But at the same time, maybe. You know, maybe he's learned enough. Maybe he knows enough. Maybe, you know, he'll cross. If he can even survive any of this, I, the hell knows. Well, like, so I don't know. I mean, I could easily see, you know, no election, but I just don't buy that either. I think that would be really dumb. But again, they're trying to push us into a moment where they're egging us on to secede. We are the South.
Yeah.
The entire United States, they're trying to get the Americans to secede. They want the libertarians, and they're purposefully amplifying libertarians, I think, in some ways.
Interesting. Could be. Makes sense. I mean, we would be a good source to undermine the federal government and push secessionary movements. Exactly. So that makes sense.
And this is why it's why I get angry with guys, you know, who then turn around and go, okay, well then all of libertarianism must have been a CIA construct from the 40s in order for this moment. And I just don't buy. That's just bullshit. That's, when I hear stuff like that, and I've heard this from, and I'm not going to name names, but they're out there. I've had them referred to me. And I think that's all nonsense. Okay. I think libertarianism as a philosophy is perfectly reasonable. I think it's an excellent critique of central planning and all of the rest of it. And I think it's a perfectly reasonable way to aspire to live your life to and all of that stuff. But in the down and dirty world of geopolitics, you are like everyone else. You are a pawn.
Right.
Because we are dealing with people who do not believe in anything other than power.
Yeah. And that's why many in the libertarian camp view the secessionary movement as a throwing over the chessboard, but it could result in ruin for sure. It's
absolutely.
Yeah. There's no assurance that it would actually improve things because you could end up in, civil war or world war. I mean, there's anything's possible.
Actually, the worst part about it is that you let these fucking inbred motherfuckers off the hook. That's the game. I won the battle. And then they win the fucking game. Like, what do you do? Like, what the hell's wrong with you? Like, they're trying to save themselves. Do you understand that Europe is their model? And if the United States breaks up in a disorderly fashion before European Union breaks up, then what fucking capital is left in Europe stays there. And the United States and all the capital that's in the United States gets dispersed. And we wind up in a dark age. They muddle through. The Chinese win the freaking game. And guess what? Those sons of bitches at the motherfucking WEF all turn around and they buy fucking Chinese stocks and they get to still live in their mansions.
Yep.
And they still get to buy their Swiss chocolates and they still get to pontificate about their bad ideas because the Chinese system is going to wind up right back up at the zero bound because they're freaking communists and they can't manage capital.
Yep, of course. And because, inevitably.
I mean, not because they're communist economically. They're not. They're communist philosophically.
Right.
And therefore, in order to maintain that authority system, they're going to have to go back to the zero bound.
Yeah. No.
They're going to wind up with funny money.
Yeah. And well, I mean, because central planning always misallocates capital, and ultimately, they're going to have to sustain the system. But here's the important question for my audience, because I'm sure they're all wondering. Mm-hmm. Assuming your thesis is correct and Powell does continue to hike or at least he keeps it where it's at, I think at these debt levels, that's enough potentially to create real issues in the debt markets and ultimately the equities markets, probably drive us into a recession. I think that's probably would be in alignment with what Powell would like to see, because as you said, we need to absorb a lot of this capital out of the system. Mm-hmm. That portends a recession. Do you foresee that in the not too distant future?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Recession is the least of your worries.
Yeah. Okay. So depression really? Is possible.
I thought you were going to give me a hard question. Sorry.
Well, I'm asking for my audience.
I know. Sake, you know. I'm just fucking with you. Seriously. what you should be thinking of now is who is okay. We had coordinated central bank policy up until 2021, and then the Fed got out of the game. Actually, the SNB got out of the game when they depegged the euro. You know, now that I think about it.
That's the Swiss National Bank.
Yeah, the Swiss National Bank. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Keep me at. Don't let me throw too much jargon at you without explaining it. When Powell, began stealth tightening in June of 2021, that's when the central bank era, coordinated central bank era, ended. Right. Mm. The dollar reserve standard has been dead since 2008, guys. It's like stop using that term. It doesn't exist. We still have a dollar trade settlement system, but we don't have a dollar reserve standard. That's dead because the banking system was dead. It's bankrupt. So now we have the dollar. Now we have the credit, the coordinated central bank system that runs from 2011 all the way to 2021. That ended. Powell's been raising rates. They got off the board. The SNB, the Swiss National Bank, they're off the board. The Bank of Japan just got off the board. They just got off the train because they're ending yield curve control or tweaking it. What that means is that they're going to allow rates to rise to try and keep capital from outflowing out of Japan. They need to stay ahead of. They're behind on inflation. Inflation in Japan is running 3.5%. Again, manipulated CPI numbers, but let's just work with the numbers we have. Not that we agree, not whether we agree with them or that we even like them, because I hate them all.
Right.
But the Japanese 10-year still trading at 66 basis points. The 2 years trading at 50 basis points or whatever the hell it is, it's not good. They've got to let yields rise. If they do that, that means that the yen is going to fall, right? Well, they have one of two options. They can either let rates rise or they can let the yen continue to fall. Their only choice. So they're off the bandwagon, right? So the ECB is the last one that they've raised rates, but they're the one that has not wanted to raise rates. The Bank of England has raised rates almost gleefully. The Bank of Canada has raised rates almost gleefully. And I have it on good authority that the Canadian banks are backing Powell's play 100%, which is why the truckers, why the people did not lose their bank accounts over the truckers' revolt. When the Canadian Senate intervened and stopped the Emergencies Act from going through, that came from that order came from TD Bank North and all those guys.
Wow. Interesting.
Flat out. Done. Have it on good authority, like directly from those people. Done. They back Powell's play in every way. So who's left of that original set bank, seven central banks? The Fed's out, BOJ's out, BOE's out, Bank of Canada's out, SMB's out, ECB. Who's left? ECB?
I don't know.
Nobody. They're all good. They're all fucking out. So what Lagarde is doing now is literally just trying to, with fingers in the dam, trying to keep doing yield curve control. And the only ally she has left is Janet Yellen over at the Treasury Department. But Janet Yellen has the problem because remember, Davos wants to destroy the United States. How do you destroy the United States? You destroy the United States by getting us to spend in ways that makes drunken sailors ashamed to be drunken sailors.
Right.
Undermine the fiscal situation, force the Fed back to the zero bound because we can't afford the debt. And Powell's like, no, it's not my problem. Go ahead, raise $1.5 trillion in capital. You're doing it at 6%. But that'll blow out the budget. Exactly. That's exactly what I want to happen. I am over this. We are done. Europe is the one that can't handle this. Europe's banks are fucked. There isn't a real bid under a German Bund at this point. Okay, so they're all out. They're all done. The whole thing is broken apart. They're in the intense negotiations of who's going to lose.
So do you think
I see it as Europe, and once the European bond markets finally explode. All that money is going to flow into the United States. The dollar is already starting to rise. We're going to get that. The U.S. equity markets are going to trade, are going to tread water. The Dow is going to tread water, if not rise. The dollar is going fucking higher. Gold is going higher. Oil is going higher.
Interesting.
The collateral-based money is going to get the ground. When when the sovereign debt markets start to go, money will get the ground. And ground means tangible assets. And the closest thing in the debt markets are hard assets, which in this case are U.S. Treasuries. So you'll see U.S. Treasuries rise slowly, but you're going to see European bond yields explode. Okay, once Lagarde loses control, just watch the German 10-year and wait for a move, a sustained move above 2.5, 2.6%, because she's targeted the shit out of that.
Okay.
And that keeps everything else in the Eurozone in place, the Italian debt, French debt, Spanish debt, all the rest of it.
Well, that gives my audience something to actually, you know, keep an eye on. What I find interesting about that is that I would have expected these elevated interest rate levels to ultimately create a recession in this country, which would usually hurt equities markets. You're implying that because it's going to be the strongest of the week, that you'll see a bunch of foreign capital hit the market to keep equities higher.
Yeah. Yeah, we are going to have capital inflow like you wouldn't believe, because there's going to be a dollar bull wave that's going to light your hair. Well, we don't have any hair, so, light somebody's hair on fire.
Light the facial hair on fire, yeah.
Yeah, we'll light the facial hair on fire. I just trimmed my beard, so it's not even very much of that, because, I wanted to look pretty for you today.
Thank you.
You should have seen the wild old man I look like this morning. I'm not allowed out in public all that often because I'm barely fit for human consumption. But... That being said, yes, the basic thesis, the basic argument is that, look, when sovereign debt, they're arguing that we're losing control and losing faith in our governments. Well, if we're losing faith in our governments, then we're going to lose our faith in our government's ability to issue debt. Like, everybody's focused, like the entire financial press and Twitter space and everything else, like, oh my God, what's happening with the dollar and the dollar and the de-dollarization, the dollar, and it's all this, like, did anybody notice the euro? Mm. Just saying.
Yeah.
What do you think is these people issued $16 trillion worth of debt at negative yields. Do you think any of those central banks are solvent? Miss a German auditor coming out and saying the Bundesbank needs a $2 trillion capital injection? The Bundesbank needs a $2 trillion capital injection.
Yeah, it's crazy. Well, I mean, this is why it's so hard for a lot of people to imagine, including myself, to imagine a deflationary environment. But if you have all of this capital that's flooding, it's basically exiting sovereign debt. It's going to flood into the American market because the global financial market realizes that the U.S. is going to be the one that's defending the dollar. That's deflationary, assets elevating in that deflation.
And there's all this dollar-denominated debt that has to be serviced.
Correct.
This is Brent Johnson's dollar milkshake theory. He's not wrong.
Yes, yes, yes.
I mean, he's not wrong. I had Brent on the podcast recently. We had a great talk.
I'm sure.
And by the way, he hates that appellation, dollar milkshake. He enjoyed it for a little while, but he doesn't like. It's like, and I don't blame him. Like it's a meme that's been played. It's played out. But the argument is you can't ignore the geopolitical imperatives at play here. Okay. And again, all the stuff we talked about with the BRICS and all this other stuff points towards gold being remonetized. And by somebody. And I think the BRICS are going to do it. And if the BRICS do it, then everybody else is going to be forced to do it.
Wow.
Because we've removed gold from the system. Let's go back to the original shame-based economy talking point that I opened the talk with today. Think of it this way. The goal of each iteration as the central at every turn since the formation of the Bank of England in 1694, every time there's been a financial panic has been to remove physical collateral a little bit more from the global financial system at each iteration, right? Yep. We've now gotten to the point where there's almost none. We have some central banks, as Ben Bernanke put it, but we still have gold on our balance sheets, tradition as far as he's concerned, but we don't need it, right? They want to go to MMT, central bank digital currencies, and carbon credits as collateral, right? That there's no collateral there.
Yeah, that's all bullshit.
That's all bullshit. It's all ephemera. I mean, for any Peter Schiff fans in the audience that still thinks that Bitcoin is useless, at least Bitcoin has scarcity. Right. At least Bitcoin has congealed electricity in the form of numbers.
Yep.
Math. It has something behind it. These people literally have shame.
Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So
and I'm shameless, so yeah. there's no value there.
I've been here for what, an hour and 10 minutes so far, or 20 minutes? Like, you know, what shame do I have left? Like, you know, I went to German Scheiße porn at some point. So you know, in order to get a laugh. Okay. So like, I know the comedy's not good, but it's free, right? So so when you think about that, we've already there. We're there, right? Martin Armstrong has put it, you know, puts it this way all the time. He says, we're at a 1,000-year low in interest rates. Do you think they're going to go lower?
Well, we're not there anymore. I mean, we were for a very long time.
Right. But yeah. We're immediately going to go back to it? No, we've all been conditioned to believe that this is what's going to occur next. But we all did it under the assumption that the Fed was, that it was all one big club and we ain't in it. But clearly, when a group within that club faces existential threat, and again, now I'm going to like pull out my libertarian street cred card, beep, and here it is. What are all cartels? Meta stable. One of the great critiques of libertarianism and of Austrian economics is that cartels, price cartels, aren't stable. Eventually, the cartel breaks down because eventually the price setting by the cartels does not serve the needs of members of the cartel, and eventually they break.
Yep.
Central banks are no different than any other cartel. And if you don't, and if you want to argue that point, if you want to argue and tell me that I'm wrong about that, I'm just going to tell you, okay, that's nice. Shut up. Turn in your libertarian street cred card with the girl at the door.
No, you're clearly right about that. That's the whole reason ESG is going to fail too.
Exactly. Exactly, Clint. You're absolutely, bingo. Yep. So There we are. Like, you know, at some point we don't argue. We can't argue this stuff emotionally, even though it's incredibly emotional. We fall back on first principles, fall back on those things that drew you to the philosophy, into the arguments in the first place. Like why they were so powerful was because they were so goddamn simple and they were so correct.
Yep.
Right. It's, you know, I say it all the time. Lies are expensive and the truth sells itself. That's why Austrian economics is so easy to sell to people. Excuse me. But so I was just going to say,
go ahead.
So they're lying to you. They're trying to build a lie-based economy, and they've run out of other people's money to create
to their lie with.
Right. It's,
you know, it's, well, but I think this is the important thing to end with, because I've had my own thesis I updated my audience on recently when it comes to the housing market. So many in my audience, as I'm sure as well in yours, have been waiting patiently trying to enter the housing market, because much of my audience are, you know, 20 and 30 year old folks. And I'm fortunate in that I've owned and sold many, many properties over my life, but they have been waiting patiently. I expected that there would have been during the lockdowns, no one could have, or at least I couldn't have foreseen that there was going to be $5-6 trillion that were just infused into the economy during that period, but it ultimately delayed the day of reckoning. There's a terrible supply shortage in housing. There's only like 1.2 million units for sale right now. Usually equilibrium is around 2 million for it to clear in a normal time. So it seems as if there's still reasons to be bullish, but then you have the countervailing factor of mortgage rates being north of 7 again, that which is historically a fairly average rate, counter to what most young people probably feel about them. Yes. I'm curious, like, how do we get back to a place of equilibrium? Because it's not affordable for young people at all. But it's also because the material costs are so elevated, you really can't add to the inventory. Builders are scared to death to build out millions of units to try and meet this market demand. I don't know what the fuck breaks first, but it just doesn't seem like it's going to last. So what's your read on
it? It's the same problem that we're seeing in the car market, right? Used car prices are way too high. I saw an article yesterday trying to tell me that Nissan canceled the Titan because the depreciation, the 5-year depreciation on it was too high at 74%. I remember when the 5-year depreciation on a Jeep Wrangler was the best in the industry at 53%.
Wow.
Okay. So, like, you know, don't blow smoke up my ass and tell me that my hair's on fire. Like, The same thing is happening in the housing market. You've got a situation where you've got millions of people sitting on their 30-year mortgages at 2.5%, 3%, 3.5%, 4%, and they're not going to sell those.
Right.
And if they are going to sell them, you're going to have to sell them on the, you're going to have to sell that at a price higher that offsets the increased cost of the financing of getting a new mortgage at 7%. So, you know, say it's a $300,000 home and it's 4 points, you know, it's, you've got, and the interest on that, say, let's just, I don't know what the numbers are, but let's just call it, it's $70,000 in interest over the life of the loan. It's probably more than that. It's probably closer to $150,000. So, the, you know, but let's just say, then you got to pony up that extra 70 up front, which is why housing prices continue to rise and home sales continue to be flat or negative, which is why new home sales are rising and existing home sales are continuing to fall. Mm-hmm. So housing prices are going to stay elevated in this environment simply because of, as you put it, supply and demand issues. Guess what? That's commodity cost push inflation. Mm-hmm. Got it in one. Now, lumber prices have pumped and dumped completely. Concrete prices are actually relatively reasonable. You know, like all that stuff is tied to the cost of diesel fuel. A lot of it is like getting my road, my private road lime rocked at the, you know, every year I spend a little bit of money on getting that thing worked on. You know, lime rock has gone from, you know, went from 375 a load to 525, and now it's back to 425. But then again, I expect diesel fuel prices to go back north of $5, $6 a gallon. Because I think oil is going back to 110 bucks a gallon.
Interesting.
Look, when now add to the your housing thesis the idea that Germans are going to want to get their money out of the European Union.
Yeah,
and they're going to come over here and they're going to buy indiscriminately.
Yeah, that's my concern, is the foreign capital just flooding here.
And the same way, but for different reasons, that they bought from 2004 to 2007 and blew a housing bubble in Florida that nearly took down the entire world because the euro was at $1.60, and they came over here and they were buying, like, they bought my mother's condo, which appreciated in price, no lie, $75,000 in 4 months.
Oh yeah. Well, that's been happening.
Literally top ticked the market because a German couple wanted a vacation property on Marco Island.
Yep.
Okay. My mother, you know, rolled up her parents' house and her house and all of that into, you know, more money than she ever thought she would ever see in her entire life in the space of 5 years. And I smartly advised her to buy 1/2 acre for me, build a small house, and pocket the $300,000.
Nice. Well done, son.
Tell that to the rest of my fucking family who then, never mind. I don't even want to get into that story. Everybody who knows me has heard that story before, how I got fucked by them. But that being said, that's going to happen again, but for the wrong reasons. Now they're going to be fleeing uncertainty and fleeing desperation there, and they won't give a shit, and they're going to drive the dollar to the moon in the process. Hmm. And they're going to do it with, they're worried about a weak euro, and they're going to be trying to figure out how they can, you know, get the return of their capital and the return on their capital.
But you see it as a strengthening dollar and strengthening real estate and equities market.
I see a stagflationary environment with a strong dollar. Okay. Rising bond yields, rising gold, rising tangible assets, rising stocks.
Is there a historical cognate that I can look
to? It's called the 1920s.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. That's the only thing I can think of.
Again. It's the same thing. Jesus, the sovereign debt crisis in Europe created that inflow, and Bernanke was wrong, and so was Milton Friedman. Again, if I had to fight anybody, I'd fight Milton Friedman. Right. You know, the whole Fight Club thing. If you could fight one person, who would you fight? I'd fight Milton Friedman because he was a fake libertarian.
I would take John McCain, but you can have Friedman.
Well, I mean, you know, John McCain. We're doing this the day after the 5th anniversary of the death of John McCain's brain tumor. And I regret to say that it only had one life to give for its country.
That reinstates your libertarian bona fides right there.
I know.
Oh, that's too funny, man.
I love that line. I used to do the weekly live streams whenever that happened. I pull that joke out, and it would just the comment threads would just, the chat would just stop. And then after about 2 minutes later, everybody's like, Raffelmau.
Blah, yeah, right, right,
oh
right,
my
right,
God,
right.
I love you. But, you know, it's the greatest joke in the world, dude. It never gets old.
Well, that's this has been, as always, incredibly insightful. Tom Luongo, please tell us, or tell my audience at least, where they can follow and support you.
Sure. You can follow the work, the public work over at my blog at tomluongo.me. I'd like to water it more often than I can, but Christ, guys, I it's so very, very difficult at this point. You can follow me on Twitter with the very worst version of me, not the one you saw today, but an even worse version shows up every day at TFL1728. And you can, of course, you can sign up at the Patreon at patreon.com/goldgoodsandguns, where you can get the monthly newsletter, where we do, you know, where we do our big, my partner Dexter White and I do our big look ahead as to what we're seeing and what's going on along with our portfolio. And then I do twice weekly market reports, which are kind of video slide presentations with talking points and charts and technical analysis and all the rest of it, bespoke chart reads for people and all of it. And as well, you know, I do private blogs for the.
Whoa, his device disconnected. What are the odds? Well, I greatly enjoyed that. He may pop back in here in a second, but I just wanted to say, I don't know if Tom Luongo is going to be right everything, but his analysis is fucking fascinating, and it's definitely worth deep consideration. Oh, he's back. Here we go. One second.
I think I made the mistake of, like, I don't know. I just made the mistake of doing it.
And now it's
an even weirder thing. Gods. Sorry about that.
No worries. No. Was there anything else?
No, that was it.
Okay. Well, I was just telling my audience, you know, I don't know if you're going to be right everything about everything, you know, to a T. Obviously, timing is going to be very interesting, and there's many variables and many warring factions at play here. But I think it's very important that people, you know, kind of break free of the, particularly my audience, break free of the puritanical libertarian view and just kind of, you know, you still keep that philosophy, obviously, but
sure,
but analyze all of these different players and warring factions as the game is played on a macro chess level that we struggle to keep our eye on. And honestly, I think very few people on earth are capable of doing it how you have just done it over this past hour and a half. So I really appreciate your time, and I hope my audience takes it to heart, whether they end up adjusting their investment portfolio or not. It was an interesting conversation nonetheless. Thank you so much, Tom.
Thank you, Clint. And I really do enjoy it. And again, you know, one of the things that you as a final note, this is for all of us. And I've been yelled at about this, and I've had to do it, and I've been there, which is we all have to up our game. It's easy to just go, you know what, I don't care. And if you want to be that guy and you want to just hodl some gold and hodl some Bitcoin and stack some coins, do so. But then you're not in the game. You're not engaged.
Yep.
And if you're going to be engaged in the fight, that's fine. But please don't backbite those of us who are actually here trying to do the work and trying to do the hard work to figure out how we can win the war. And the war is won via little individual battles and little individual moments.
Yeah.
It's not just, let's just move to the end. If you want to get to the end and flip to the end of the book, great. But you got to read, in my mind, in my position, I got to read every page as it goes along.
I agree. And if you understand the stakes here, which are not just astronomical, but arguably existential, I think it's worth being involved and trying to sway the conversation into our worldview and hopefully guide this thing so we can avoid the worst of the potential outcomes. So
and we do it in such a way that we come across as responsible crafters of policy and statecraft.
Right.
Like, and that's hard.
Yeah.
Where you have to be a critic and you have to, like, hold it back and then go, look, it's, you know, I'm out here advocating Powell go to 7%. I want to break as much of this as possible. But at the same time, I also realize I may be wrong about that. Like,
sure,
there's a vandal part of me as well that says, dude, come on, like 7%. And maybe he's already done enough, which is why I kind of dodged the question earlier. Is Powell going to go higher? He's going to do what he needs to do.
Mm-hmm.
He may have already done enough. Daniel Yamar Tino Boots thinks he's already done too much. I don't know. I know that until I see the European Union of smoking ruin and Christine Lagarde's Adam's apple quivering and she has to wear another find another red neck scarf to cover it up, I'm not satisfied. It's got to be full and complete destruction of these fucking commie sons of bitches of a particularly odious European variety. Period. I mean, I'm sorry, but Russian and Chinese comedies are not, they're bad and they're the problem, but they're not, these Euro comedies are bad.
Yeah, man.
They're people.
Bad
people.
I've spent the past couple years really laying out how dangerous their worldview is. It's an amalgamation of the worst ideas humanity has ever attempted to foist upon itself. And I just, anything we can do potentially to prevent that is mandatory.
And those terrible ideas, Clint, propagate to infinity at the zero bound.
Yeah, facts.
There's a corrupt money begets a corrupt society. And
facts.
When you're at the zero bound, you got maximal corruption, maximum corruption within the society, maximally corrupt money. So we've got to get back to real. And again, Dr. Ron was right about these. St. Ron was right about all these things. Of course he was. Was he right to highlight and the Fed? Absolutely he was. But as a general critique of central banking, but not as a necessarily roadmap to how we get to where we need to go.
Yep.
And I think that as a cohort within the political commentary in the political space, we need to get better into drilling down and saying, look, we can do this.
Yep.
We can fix the budget. We can roll spending back to 2018 levels. We can throw gold down on the yield curve. We can do all these things that I've talked about in other interviews. Like, you and I could do another hour on this. I can explain how to get out of it. I have a plan. And it's not even a terrible plan. I've got news for you. It's probably the plan that's already been discussed by the people who are desperately trying to get wrest control from the crazies on Capitol Hill.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So
I believe you.
All right. With that said, I'll leave that for the next time I'm on. We'll talk about that the next time I'm on.
I'm sure after this one, people will be DMing me tomorrow saying, when are you going to have Tom Longowek on? If anybody
whenever
wants
you want, Clint, you know, whenever's good for you, dude, whatever works for your schedule.
Sounds good, brother. Thank you so much. If anybody wants to support my work, go to libertylockdown.locals.com, or you can go and subscribe to me over on Twitter, aka X. I am now monetized, so you guys can support my work there. I appreciate all of the support I've been getting. We're doing 20,000 plus per episode now. It's amazing. I really appreciate it. Wow. And hopefully it's just a sign of not just the beginning of things for me, but for this movement more broadly. And I think that Tom Luongo is a very important voice in that. So once again, Tom, I appreciate your time.
Nah, Clint, the pleasure was all mine, dude. I couldn't find a better way to prep for a hurricane. You guys do well. We'll talk to you soon.
Later, man.
Welcome to Liberty Lockdown. Please scan your barcode. Your liberty ain't gone, but yeah, it's on hold. Where did it come from and where did it go?